Welcome to another exciting Bible study with Reverend Dr. James A. Dunkins, pastor of Shiloh Baptist Church. Faith study in the Word is designed to keep you fired up about your walk with the Lord. Fired up about our faith study in the Word with Pastor Dunkins, author, teacher, and long-term educator with a burning desire to see every believer live a full life of faith in the redeeming power of God. This can only happen when we develop a hunger and thirst for studying the Word, God's Word. Thanks for joining us in tonight's study.
Praise the Lord. Good evening. You have just joined into another fantastic teaching of Fired Up About Our Faith. Let me start here. God has given us unlimited power because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have unlimited power. There is no need for any saint of God to find themselves in a situation that you can't get out of. Isn't that some way to start a Bible study? God, I'll say it again, has given us unlimited power because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The question is, if God has given us unlimited power, why do we find ourselves sometimes in a place that it seems like we cannot get our deliverance? Please hear me. It's because even though you have unlimited power, all of us have to keep growing spiritually. We have to get out of one level of faith, go to the next level of faith. We got to get out of one place, and we're supposed to continually growing because our trials and our journey and our walk in God is made for us to grow and get stronger as we go through it. When you are stuck, or when you're in a place that you can't get out of, it just means, which I'm teaching tonight, that you need another level, or you need to break through to the next level. Listen to that terminology very carefully, because we throw that word breakthrough around. I'm not talking about a breakthrough because I'm hurting and I got to get somewhere. I'm saying that God has actually set in front of us the opportunity with the power that we have, that we are supposed to break through to a new spiritual level. And when I break through to my new spiritual level, the trials and tribulations are taken care of. When you break through to your new spiritual level, you won't be on your knees crying, talking about God, why? When you break through to your new spiritual level, you'll understand, not only do I know more, can do more, and see more. And the reason they call it a breakthrough is because it is something that you have to fight your way through. And it's something that God will help you with, but you got to actually put energy into it. A breakthrough won't work until you work it. So we're going to talk about tonight the keys to your spiritual breakthrough. How do you get to that level? How do I get... Someone says, well, Pastor, I'm pretty good now. No, we were never meant to stop at a level. God has unlimited power so that we can achieve all that we are supposed to achieve supernaturally. So we're going to look at the disciples tonight. Grab your Bibles. In this very familiar passage, Mark's Gospel, chapter 9. We're going to look at Mark's Gospel, chapter 9, and you're going to see that the disciples are going to be our example, or they're going to show us, even as a disciple for Christ, they were in need of a spiritual breakthrough. I didn't say they weren't going, I didn't say they weren't following God, they weren't going to church, they weren't shouting, but they needed a stronger spiritual breakthrough in order to handle their present problem. My brothers and sisters, you need a breakthrough, a spiritual breakthrough, to handle your problems. John, Mark's Gospel, chapter 9. Let's read. Begin at verse 1. And he said unto them, verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here, which shall not taste death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. This is Jesus talking to a crowd, and he has pointed out something that seems miraculous. He says, some of you standing here won't see death until you've seen the Son of God come in power. After the 6 days, Jesus takes with him Peter, James, and John and leads them up unto a high mountain apart by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. Now, I need you to see that, because it said after 6 days, after making that statement, he took Peter, James, and John up to the mountain. They were called his inner circle. I don't know if you know it or not, but everybody can't be in your inner circle. What I'm saying is you can't have everybody in your business. Everybody doesn't mean you will not add to your spiritual growth. Some folk are going to pull you down. All I'm saying, if Jesus Christ had an inner circle, even out of his 12 disciples, God is just letting us know. He's giving us information. Watch the friends that you allow in your inner circle. It could be that they are hindering you and not helping. So Jesus took his inner circle. We're going to find out later they were his inner circle. And his raiment became shining white, exceeding white as snow, verse 3, so as no fuller on earth can white them. A fuller was just someone who dyed cloth, someone who was in the business of making different colors in cloth. And it said that Jesus was so white that the fuller, the clothed dyer, could not have made material as white. It was the whitest white they had seen. And there appeared unto them Elijah, Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said, Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make thee three tabernacles, one for thee and one for Moses and one for Elias. The Bible says that Peter jumped up, as Peter does, and said, this is good. That's one thing I like about Peter. He knows what's good. He said, let's make three houses here so we can stay. And the Bible tells us in verse 6, the only reason he said that, because he didn't know what else to say. That's the Bible's way of saying Peter was impulsive. He thought before he spoke. He spoke before he thought. Verse 7, and there was a cloud that overshadowed them. Come on, follow with me. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, hear ye him. And suddenly, when they had looked around about, they saw no man anymore except Jesus only with themselves. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should not tell any man what things they had seen till the Son of Man we risen from the dead. And they kept saying with themselves, questioning one with another, what the rising of the dead should mean. We're going to talk about that. Walking with him and not even knowing the divine plan that God had. We'll talk about that. And they kept saying within themselves, questioning one with another, what does rising from the dead mean? Verse 11, and they asked him, saying, why say they, the scribes, that Elisha must come first? And he answered and told them, Elisha verily cometh first and restoreth all things, and how it is written of the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be set at naught. But I say unto you that Elisha indeed come, and they have done unto him whatsoever they listed, as it was written unto them. He was explaining unto them the reality of him coming on the scene, and we know that John the Baptist symbolically was Elisha, but they didn't even recognize that John the Baptist was the forerunner, because they were thinking in terms of the Jews. They were thinking in terms of their understanding of the Messiah coming, which did not include two coming. So we'll talk about that. And it says, but I say unto you, Elijah's deed had come. Okay. And when he came down, verse 14, now we're getting to our place, to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them and the scribes questioning with them. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, and running to him saluted. And he asked the scribes, what question ye with them? And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which had a dumb spirit, and wheresoever he taketh him, he tears him, and he foameth him, and gnasheth his teeth, and pineth upon him. And I spake unto your disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. Jesus' disciples, who walked with him, that had power, I'm sitting there now, I want you to grab this. They could not. But the next statement Jesus says lets us know they should have been able to. What I'm saying to you is, somebody sitting there now, there's some could not in your life, and there's some, and Jesus is steady telling you, or the Spirit of God is saying, but you should be able to. You cannot, but you should be able to. And the reason you cannot is you're on one level and you need to break through to a spiritual level that God already prearranged for you to walk in. Wow. God already prearranged for me to be able to handle what I'm going through. That ought to give somebody some comfort today to know that God has given us a level. He said, here's the unlimited power, but now I know that there's a level of breakthrough that I have assigned to your life that will make sure you can escape every problem. And how we know that's true, if you read one more verse with me, Jesus looked at them and he said, verse 19, faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me. Wow. Okay, here we go. What are the keys to your spiritual breakthrough? First of all, I need you to understand something. God never promised us carte blanche deliverance. Carte blanche is a French term that means open, wide, or white. It means something that is, the definition is an unlimited ability to do as you want to do. You're under no authority. I have carte blanche privilege. I can do what I want. I have carte blanche privilege. The military had carte blanche orders that they could, the president gave them carte blanche orders to do what they wanted to do in the battle. Listen to me. God never set up deliverance carte blanche, meaning you can't just live any kind of way and think you can get delivered. You can't go Monday through Sunday picking and choosing when you're going to read the word, when you're going to take time to be with him, when you're going to go somewhere and pray. You can't just do that and then wonder when something happens, why haven't I been delivered? Why can't I get through it? What you're saying is, I've been saved so long. Some people say that I'm so spiritual, I know what to do. And so you just do whatever you want, and then you think God is supposed to fit his deliverance into your scheme of things, the way you do things. But that's not how deliverance works. God said, I've given you power, but it's not so you can just, I don't feel like reading this week. I haven't prayed, but now Wednesday something detrimental happens. I haven't prayed since Sunday, but Wednesday something detrimental happens. And I get on my knees and I act like that Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday that I did not spend with the Lord is not supposed to count toward my deliverance. And we're walking around trying to do carte blanche with God, but we don't do it anywhere else. We don't do it on our job. You don't expect to get paid. Okay, you worked, and it's your check. But you know what happens? You expect to get paid the money that you have worked for, but also you follow the rules. You show up on time. You sign in when they say sign in. You don't leave too early. Why? Because you don't. Even though it's your check, you don't have carte blanche. In a marriage, you can't be carte blanche, no. In a marriage, you definitely can't. Anybody who's married will tell you that there are rules to stay married. And if you want to do what you want, it just does not work. Some days when you get married, you're going to have to answer to someone else. The marriage can be good or it could be bad. Try to do everything you want, not including your partner, and watch what happens in a disintegrating relationship. It's not all about you. And thirdly, your driver's license. You got a driver's license, but you just can't ride down the road any way you want. You have to follow the rules. My question to you is, if God has laid out rules for deliverance, you're sitting there now, maybe even questioning why your life is where it is. Maybe it's because you don't understand that I can't live any kind of way and still be delivered. I can't. I got to follow what God. And you know what? What's really crazy about that is, as soon as we really get in a situation where we need to be delivered, you know what we do? We go to the scripture and do everything line by line. We follow everything God says. We start praying. We turn away from our sins and our vices because you know I got to get in line for that blessing. And yet, we don't understand that the disciples had to find out the hard way. They had privilege and they had power, but they just couldn't live like they want. And I need to go here. Unfortunately, God demands more of some of us than he does for others. There's some of us out there, I know I felt this way. God, why do you demand that of me? I see other folk you don't demand that of. Because God says, I'm demanding. I'm not even going to make you a promise that he's going to give you more. I'm just saying God makes demands on us because we're his children. He is the potter. We are the clay. He knows what he expects from us. He's laid out our destiny. So he expects you to be able to follow the rules. I just hit somebody. Stay with me. He expects you to live. He expects you to follow the rules. So look at Mark's gospel. I'm going to put this up so you can see it. I'm going to outline the events of this ninth chapter, Mark. Let me move this aside, because I'm not going to use that right now. Mark's gospel, the transfiguration, covers verses 1 through 13. We read that. Next comes the exorcism of the demon-possessed child, which is really going to be our focus. Then comes, but you need to see all of this, the disciples go into this thing of who's the greatest. Right? And that's verses 30 to 37. And then how to treat those on the Lord's side, verse 38 to 50. Let me take it back so you can see it again. Transfiguration, verses 1 through 13. The exorcism of the demon-possessed child. We're going to talk about the reality of the demonic. You living with the demonic, you fighting a spiritual battle. What you're looking at, there's a whole lot more demonic situations that occur because of our thinking we can live any kind of way. But when we do, we open the door and the enemy comes in. I can't tell you the number of times in my relationship, if I had an honest person, that I am responsible for opening that door to the doubts. I open the door by my actions. I open the door by this little thing right here, my tongue. Hello, Pastor. I open the door by things I said, things that were detrimental to me. I mean, I wanted to get out of it, but I opened the door because really the devil has no authority to come in unless I let him in. So we got to fight him, but I opened the door for him. And that's why we're going to talk about how you exercise the devil out of your life. And of course, I understand, you know, you're good New Testament biblical scholars, and you understand that even though the enemy may not get a total possession on us once we become born again, that he can oppress us and control us, which is almost just as bad if we think we want to live the way we want. Watch this. Who is the greatest? When you have that kind of mentality, you're leaving God out the picture. And next, how do you treat those on the Lord's side? You know, the disciples had that talk about who was the greatest. I'm not even going to teach that, so I'm just going to tell you about it. And Jesus started talking to them about what real greatness was. And then they saw somebody casting out demons in Jesus' name. And they said, we saw somebody casting out demons in your name, Lord. And we rebuked him. Jesus said, wait a minute. If he's using my name, then he's on our side. Isn't it something how our denominations, how our church, how our allegiances sometimes get us to thinking we're better than someone else or that the, you know, I always use this example because it just cracks me up sometimes. How some people say, well, I know you can lose your salvation. There's no eternal security. And I tell you, the first question I always ask is, how come you haven't lost yours? And you know where they always go? They always start telling me, well, not me. I'm not going to lose mine. Well, what makes you any different than someone else? All you're doing is raising yourself up above someone else. If you don't want to lose your salvation, what makes you think I want to lose mine? No. We got to make sure we understand how to treat those who are on the Lord's side. Come on, let's get into this. So let's look at the transfiguration first. The inner circle. I love this. Thus, these three witnesses witnessed Jesus' greatest moments of glory and his darkest trial. They were his closest friends. We just gave you the text. Jesus came out and said that out of the folk here standing, right, some of them will not die until they see the Lord coming in power. Now, I've heard people put all kind of spooky twist on that about, you know, not dying. But let's look at what the text literally actually says. It goes into 6 days later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John. his inner circle up to a mount, high in a mountain, where he was transfigured. 6 days later, he took them. They were among the group that he said would not die until he sees the Lord coming in power. 6 days later, he took them up and he was transfigured. Ooh, listen, he was transfigured. Look at that word. Don't count this as lightly. Can you imagine being Peter, James, and John? Here is Jesus, who you know is a prophet, who you know is human, but all of a sudden he is transfigured in front of you, glowing white as snow, looking anointed, looking full of power, and you're watching this. And then you see him standing there talking to Elisha and Moses. Wait a minute. How did they know it was Elisha and Moses? Because maybe they knew it by what the description in the text of what Moses and Elisha wore. I don't know. Here is how I think. I think that the Holy Spirit witnessed in their spirit. I believe there's sometimes in your life when God sends you a revelation that he wants you to hear. I think by revelation, he knew that disciples would know this was Moses, who was one of their greatest. He was the father. He was one of the greatest heroes, patriarchs of their faith. And then Elisha, who they knew was a part of the coming of Jesus. Their prophecy said Elisha must come first. Think about that. So here's the explanation of verse 1. So they witnessed Jesus coming in his power. They witnessed Jesus coming in his power. I'm going to prove that through the text. Look what happened. These three men were present with Jesus during some of the most special events in his life. I believe scripturally that if Jesus can trust you, he can take you with him. I believe there's places God wants to take you. And he cannot take you because he can't trust. I believe he wants to show you something miraculous, show you something invincible, show you something supernaturally. I believe God can't show you the supernatural because at this point he can't trust you to try to follow what he wants you to follow. His inner circle. Now we know Peter, James, and John were not the best folk. Hallelujah, Jesus. I'm glad you don't have to be the best saints to be in his circle, but you got to be the most desperate or the ones he can trust. What I mean by that, that most of us who have sinned a whole lot, hallelujah, are the ones God can trust, because he knows that deep down inside, maybe you can go away without him. Maybe you can live without him. How many of you know I have gotten to the point where I know I don't want to spend a moment, a day, or an hour without Christ? I need somebody to praise him right there. If you know in your heart, tell the devil you're picking on the wrong person, because I realize I am nothing. I would fall apart without God. I believe that's why he took old crazy Peter and he took arguing James and John. You remember, they were the ones fighting. Put me on the right hand and when you get the glory, put me on your right hand. They were arguing, and yet they were the ones who God knew had his heart. I'm explaining something. Sometimes we see the craziest people God using, and you know why God can use them? Because he can trust them. They're not the best yet, but he knows once they get some pain, or once he gives an instruction, or once they get to a certain place in life, they will straighten up. Where are you out there? Where are the saints out there would say, I know what he's talking about, because I know I've stepped outside the line even in private, and God chastised me, and my conscience wouldn't let me sleep, and I had to line my life back up with God. Don't let this pandemic lull you to sleep, and you don't line yourself up with God. So he took them to let me show you how I know God can trust his inner circle. I got to hurry. They were eyewitnesses at the transfiguration where we are now. He didn't let anybody see that. Matter of fact, he charged them, don't tell anybody. Then witnessing Jesus raise Lazarus from the dead. If you read that story in Luke's gospel, chapter 8, verse 49 to 56, you're going to see that he put everybody else out. And he let them see him raise Jairus' daughter from the dead. Write the text down. Luke 8, 49, 40, 56. I got to hurry and get through this. When he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, he had all of them there, but he took Peter, James, and John when he went a distance off. And of course, they fell asleep. But I'm telling you, when God can trust you, I can't tell you the number of days I was not fit to be in the pulpit. I was not fit, in my estimation, in my estimation, God should not have had so much mercy and grace on me, but somehow he knew that I would come to my senses. I got hope out there for somebody. You might not be the best, but keep on trusting and watch God take you into his inner circle, whisper in your ear in the midnight hour. But here's what I want you to know. The reason I can verify, I need you to write this down, that what Jesus was talking about when he said they won't taste death. So somebody don't give you some spooky stuff. All you got to do is follow the scripture. I always tell you, scripture answers scripture. You don't have too many outliers. When you see somebody taking the scripture all out of context, it means they're trying to make up something to make you feel good. But I want to share with you, the reality of God's word is better than some made up revelation that makes you feel good for a moment. Look at what Jesus said. Peter himself witnessed in 2 Peter 16-18. For we have not followed, listen to what Peter said. We have not followed cunningly devised fables, what I just told you. When we made known unto you the power, look at the words, and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we were eyewitnesses of this mystery. Fits the text, doesn't it? He says, some of you will not taste death until you see me coming in my power. Peter used those words. Look what he said. For we receive from God the Father honor and glory. For he received, talking about Jesus, from God honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear you him. Look what the text said. The reason I said well pleased the first time is because in the different translations, Luke's gospel says, well, please. Mark's gospel just says, hear ye him. But it's Peter giving us an explanation for that text. They saw him coming in his power. He was with Elisha and Moses. What's significant about that? Because Elisha and Moses represent those folk who are caught up with God. You do know Elisha and Moses didn't die. This is getting good. Elisha and Moses didn't die. We're not going to die. Somebody said, we're going to die. Yeah, we're going to die physically, but there's going to be some of us that's going to be caught up with God. When Jesus died on the cross, so I can explain myself, he said, death, where is your sting? He took away the sting of death, meaning that we don't have to worry about dying hopelessly. But Moses, as you know, was carried off. We can go to the book of Jude and we can find out that Michael the archangel had to fight against Satan because he wanted Moses' body. I think that's Jude verse 9 talking about that. So we know Moses went to glory even though he didn't get a chance to go into the promised land. He just saw the promised land. We know he was taken up. And of course we know Elisha was. So Moses represents those who die and go to glory. Elisha represents those who are caught up to heaven without death. So if we were to look, 1 Thessalonians 4:17, you know, we did a series already telling you about these could be the end times. It says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So if we had the privilege, and don't think that it's not time, Christ could come back any moment. Don't let anybody fool you. And if Christ came back, you know what would happen? Automatically we'd be caught up in the air. But they also represent something else that gives a significance to the power of God. Moses represents the law. Elisha represents the prophets. So in the Old Testament, you had the law and the prophets. In the New Testament, you had grace and mercy. So I love how God does this. God allowed him. Somebody said, why didn't Abraham come back? You know, why didn't somebody else come back? Because God was trying to show his order of all things. Look what he did. He allowed him to have Elisha and Moses because they represented two dispensations and they represented two ways of dying and they represented two testaments. What do I mean? The sum of the Old Testament revelations, the law and the prophets, came to meet with Jesus at the Mount Transfiguration, who represents the New Testament. So Jesus was coming in his power. And the power was solidified by the fact that when they got into this transfigured state, he had the law, he had the prophets represented in Moses and Elijah. How do we know? Because John's gospel, the gospel of John, watch this, guys. 1:17 says, "For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus." So all of a sudden, you had the law and the prophets, the Old Testament meeting the New Testament as God was about to strike out on his plan of redemption. I love how all of God's word fits together, but it also lets us know we're not just building our life on a whim. This stuff has been thought out and planned by the I am that I am. You don't have to sit there now worrying about can you be delivered or is anything coming over you. God made plans a long time ago. There's no holes in his plans. You're going to get out. You got out before. You know you're going to get out again. He made sure that he put things together on top of each other. Just when the enemy thinks he got, somebody testify here, that's when I escaped. And don't think that escape wasn't planned by God. Just when the enemy thought he had you. Look, how do I know that? This is so powerful. They talked, the scripture says, Moses and Elisha talked to Jesus. What did they talk about? Luke 9, 30-31 tells us this. Now, I love this. So Moses and Elisha came. They were transfigured with Jesus. And all of a sudden, they began to talk to Jesus. Now, they were before Jesus. Well, they really weren't. Jesus said, I was before Abraham. But they now got a chance to hear the plan of redemption from Jesus' mouth. I know you thought that the Messiah was coming, Elisha. I know you guys didn't understand, you know, that I have to die first. And I believe Jesus talked about that. How do we know? Because the text tells us, and behold, there they talk with him, two men which were with Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory, and they spoke of his decease, which he should accomplish at Jerusalem. Jesus explained to, I bet you Moses and Elijah was shouting up some. They were, oh my God, I give Moses high-fiving Elijah. Yeah, man, I knew, man, my God did it. All I'm saying is, can you imagine hearing from Jesus Christ, who is the Son of God, but who also is God, second person in the Godhead, Jesus Christ, who is God, told them, this is what's going to happen, guys. I can't stay there, but that's exciting. And they, now, the disciples, from verse 5 to 13, I can't stay there, but we're going right to our text. But I want you to know how I'm easing into this, what was going on, and why Jesus was not infuriated, but why he couldn't understand why his disciples could not. He was constantly working the plan of redemption. He was doing everything God said. He would go away and pray and go off and pray. He took James. Listen to me. He took James, Peter, James, and John. All I'm saying is Jesus is showing us to get to his next level of breakthrough spiritually. He had to do everything his Father assigned him. How did he know to get to that place to be transfigured? Because he always knew if I keep moving and following God, something's going to happen. I got to stop for a minute. I need to talk to someone because the Holy Spirit just dropped me on your mind. You have to make sure you keep following God. No matter how dark it gets, no matter how bad your situation is, God has an escape route. I'm telling you, God wants somebody to realize that everything you're going through, cross the T's, dot the I's, keep stepping, he will be there. They did not understand. You know what happened? I'm not doing these verses. Let me just say. So they saw Jesus. They turned around, and nobody was there but Jesus. Jesus said, don't tell anybody about this. And then he talked about, for the Son of Man must suffer. They didn't understand what that meant. He said, but I'm going to die first. What does it mean by coming back from the dead? They had no idea. That's when one of them jumped up and said to Jesus, well, I thought Elisha had to come first. And he said, hey, Elisha has come. They didn't realize he was talking about John the Baptist, as we know as a forerunner. And y'all treated him very badly. So Jesus was giving his disciples stuff that I know they were able to piece back together when they got into the book of Acts after Jesus died. And it said those 40 days he came back and talked with them. I bet you they had a whole lot of aha moments, especially Peter, James, and John, as they were looking at him telling him about the fulfillment. But now let's get to the critical part of our text. The exorcism of a demon-possessed son. There are no I saw one text that said that he was having grandma seizures, trying to explain away demons. No, when the Bible says it was demonic, it was demonic. We can read through the text where it says, and every time when Jesus showed up, the demon threw him in the fire. Seizures don't happen on cue. That's demonic activity. I don't have time to teach demons. It's going to be one of the lessons I'm going to teach later, probably beginning of next year. I want to talk about the reality of the demonic in our life, the authority we have over it, but what we need to do to make sure that it doesn't get us. But watch this. When Jesus came back, they were questioning his disciples. And we found out because they could not. The world sees us as an extended arm of Christ. They say those Christians, that even though they may talk about us, we know when they get in trouble, who they turn to? Who call you up and say, pray? So they need to see, even if they are still walking around unsaved, haven't received him, they still like to see and know that there's power. Any pastor or chaplain or deacon or some of you to go to the hospital, they love to accommodate your prayers because they have documented that prayer works. So the world, even when I was out in the world, I knew that the last line of defense to craziness was I was going to go back to God. So they question us because they believe we are representatives of Jesus Christ. You are God's representative. What do you represent? They question you when you don't have power because they thought you represented God. How can you not stand when you're trying to witness to me to come get what you got when I don't see you with nothing? You have to realize they will question you. Why do they question us? Because we are his witnesses. Acts 1:8. But you shall receive power, dunamis, inherent dynamite, power that helps you, which is authority. You have the dunamis or the authority of God shall come from on high, cover you, blanket you, come into you. And the first thing he said that power will do, after you get the Holy Ghost, you shall be my witnesses. We are some sorry witnesses if we cannot fight through to get to our own testimony. The reason the world's going to question you, and sometimes you question yourself, is because we are supposed to be witnesses. And then he said, and how I know people will question you or the world wants to see it, he said, because you'll be witnesses in Jerusalem, which is right in your home. You know, we talked about it before, but a whole lot of folk aren't saved because they know you. A whole lot of your family members aren't saved because they see you. A whole lot of people that could be saved aren't saved because they see our compromise. They see our inability to handle trials. They see us just as funky as they are. And so they wonder, why should I come get something that seems like you only run to when you're desperate? Watch this. He said, at home, then in Judea, take the word out, in Samaria and the uttermost parts of the world. We are God's witnesses. That's why when a Christian does something, it rings out like crazy. Romans 8:17. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. What this is saying is, and if... because we are children of God, we are heirs with Jesus Christ, talking about the power still. Joint heirs with God. We have the same power. Jesus was the firstborn of many brethren from the dead, meaning that he died and made it possible for us to be in the family of God. He died, got the inheritance. I'm his brother. You're his sister. We get the same inheritance from God, the same abilities, the same power, the same ability to fight. While you're sitting there watching this Bible study and you're going to flip through and you find some other Bible study, none of that will do you any good till you know you are an heir. Somebody ought to say that with me. I am a joint heir. I have the power to overcome darkness. I have the power to overcome anything coming against me. I have the power to get out of this situation. And it says, so be that we suffer with him. That's what heirs do. we may also be glorified together. The glory comes from the suffering. They questioned them because we're supposed to have answers. 1 Peter 3:15, but sanctify, set apart the Lord God in your heart, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Your answer about how you made it should never be you boasting about you. David said, my soul makes her boast in the Lord. My soul says, if it had not been. My soul says, I know it was the Lord. I know it was the blood. I know it was that redemption on the cross. I've been born again. I've been changed. I've been saved. Can anybody? I've been changed by the power of God. He got up on that third day. And because he got up, I have the power. I got to be able to tell somebody, how did you make it back from that trouble in your life? I found a scripture where God said he forgave me, and when he forgives me, I'm forgiven. How did you, and you know, it also says in Psalms 103 that far as the east is from the west. So while you're walking around with a bag load of guilt, I gave that problem to God last week, and I didn't pick it back up again. So now when I mess up and do the same thing, God don't remember it. All it makes me do is repent, because I know I got a God who never left me or forsook me. So what happens? I got to be able to give an answer for the hope. Every Christian should have hope that is in you with meekness, that's tenacity and fear. 2 Corinthians, therefore we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Look, we are ambassadors. You know, I've shared this with you on several cases, but if you go to, if you're in the United States, if you're in Germany or Russia, there is an American embassy. When you get into the American embassy, no matter what you've done in Germany, you are now standing in America. When I walk inside that embassy, I am an ambassador. So no matter where I stand on the earth, where I stand, it's holy ground because I'm a child of God. That's why we don't have to have a building to be the church. Because wherever we are, where the Spirit of God shows up, that building gets sanctified. When we're in the building, it gets sanctified. So understand, we need to make sure we understand that we have to give answers because we're the ambassadors. They question us about our witness. They question us because they want answers. And they question us because we're supposed to have power. I'm going to do this, and then we'll probably end tonight with they could not. And we'll pick this up. But I want you to see this. 2 Timothy 1:7. For God, I'm not stuttering. For God, we're still talking about demons, has not given me a spirit of fear. So when a spirit of fear comes, I can cast it down. Somebody said, I've been casting it down for weeks. You may have to do it 2 weeks. But every time a spirit of fear comes, you got to make sure you disown it and don't act like it can get comfortable in your life. Oh, what am I talking about? When something is yours, God didn't give me the spirit of fear. So I can't take something that's not mine. I will not accept something negative that's not mine. It says, but God gave me power. Power would be good enough. But then he gave me love and he gave me a sound mind. I chose this scripture first because a lot of us are bogged down in this pandemic. They've shown cases where people's mental health is going down. But you need to understand, God did not give us a spirit of fear. He gave us a sound mind. 2 Corinthians, for the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. You better quit reading your Bible like it's just some words. No, it is God breathed. It is God breathing on you. When God breathed that word, when you speak it, you're speaking a word that's full of power. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask to think according to the power that works in us. Ephesians 3:20. I'm telling you why they question us, because we do have power. I love this. We have power that's exceedingly and abundantly more than we can ask or think. You're writing, I told you to write fast. Ephesians 1:19, and what is the exceeding greatness of the power toward usward who believe according to the working of his mighty power. Now, look what this text says. And what is the exceeding, there's that word again, greatness of his power to usward, believers, who believe according to the working of his mighty power. So, I'm going to let you get these scriptures, then we're going to move right in. Ephesians 3:20, you got Ephesians 1:19. Just write down Ephesians 3:20. Write down 1 Corinthians 4:20. And write down 2 Timothy 1:7. Now let's move forward. Our problem. Here is the problem of spiritual breakthrough. It's got nothing to do with what I say. It's got nothing to do with what anybody else says. Here's what it comes down to. They could not. What does it mean they could not? It says, Mark 9:18. And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth, and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And I spake to your disciples that they should cast him out. We expected them to because they're your representatives. We expected it to because they have answers. They should have answers. They should have an answer for me. Why my son ain't healed? We expected them to because they have power. Right? He said, they could not. Ooh, I don't want to leave you here, but listen. I told you when I started this Bible study, God gave us unlimited power. You got to have a breakthrough to the next level. The unnamed son was demon possessed. And as a demon possessed unnamed son, they could not cast out the demon. What happened to their power? They had it. Luke 10:17. When Jesus sent his disciples out in the Gospel of Luke, he chose his disciples. Luke 10, he sent them out. You know, don't take, you know, every place that they don't receive, you kick the dust off your feet. Take no script, take no coat. You know the text. And it says, when they came back, the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through your name. Wait a minute. If the devil was subject unto you, why are you in that condition now? Wow, you must have forgot about your power. God didn't give you the spirit of fear. All I'm saying is they expected and the disciples should have been able to cast the demon out, but they could not. And at one time they could. What are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying one day you can be strong, but if you don't keep moving and going from one level of spirit to another, you're living off of last year's fumes, and you're wondering why there's no joy in your heart now. No, you got to keep moving, not just to get back to a place, but to go further than you were. Luke 10:19, look what Jesus said. Behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions over all the power of the enemy, and nothing, somebody say nothing, nothing shall by any means hurt you. I'm going back to this one. Luke 10. Remember I told you he sent the disciples out? When they came back rejoicing, verse 18 says, and look, I behold and saw Satan coming down from heaven like lightning. And then he told them, don't worry. See, even though you're coming back rejoicing now, Satan's not done with you yet. He says, so I got to remind you, I gave you power to tread, to walk on serpents, talking about demons and demonic spirits. You know, it's always, whenever they say serpents and scorpions, it's symbolic of the darkness and the spirits that try to attack us. Mark 9:28, and when he was coming to his house, his disciples asked him privately, why could not we cast him out? Here are your keys. Not dramatic, but it's so powerful. This kind, what you're dealing with, comes forth by nothing but prayer and fasting. That goes a little beyond just your regular walk, huh? That goes beyond your checking in every now and then with the Bible. That goes beyond you waiting on the church to set you a fast day. No, if you're hurting, you ought to set your own. That goes beyond. I don't know what kind of demons are attacking you. I don't know what's going on with your family. I don't know what's in your house. I do know you're in a warfare because all of us are in it. And all I'm saying is the keys to your next breakthrough. The disciples were at a place where they had power. God gave them the power, but they could not use it. Why? Because they needed a breakthrough. And Jesus said, the only way you're going to get through this, you got to separate your time with some prayer and fasting. I love this because the combination of prayer and fasting are used multiple times in the Bible. But prayer and fasting are your keys. Prayer and fasting are the keys to spiritual breakthrough. Write it down. We think fasting is punishment, but it is the keys to spiritual breakthrough. Because one of the toughest area in our life is our flesh. And you know, true fasting in the Bible, besides the Daniel fast, most fasting, you know, we've adjusted fasting to cover denying stuff. You know, like we want television or, you know, sodas, or I'm going to do no sweets. Nothing wrong with that. But true fasting is when you give up food. Even if you have to go to the Daniel fast. Why? Because you're bringing anguish to your flesh. Anybody ever been hungry? Come on. When you're hungry, you know, you heard people say, I'm hungry enough to eat a cow. I can eat a horse. All I'm saying is, I have been so hungry, I'm busting open bags as I'm coming from the grocery store. You ever been there? I'm walking in the house cooking and eating. I'm not by myself. What am I telling you? When our flesh, it sounds like it's, you know, kind of harsh when it comes to food. But what about it comes to your healing? What about is the only way you can get healed is to cast down that demon that has attacked you, but your flesh is so strong because you never put your flesh down. You let it dominate. What about when it comes to your, you know, standing in the gap and interceding for your children, but you're so weak you can't even get a prayer through for you? See, the keys is we need to understand the words "this kind" is not just talking about demons. It's really talking about this kind of situation, this kind of trouble, this kind of magnitude of problems that if I'm going to make it through, I have to learn how to have some time of prayer and fasting. So first of all, we know this kind means this kind of demon. The text says when Jesus walked up, the demon threw him in the fire. So it was a demon. It was darkness. If you have not read about demon and darkness, you need to understand the Bible tells us when the unclean spirit goes out of a man, it walks the earth, gone about dry places. And when it comes back, if you have not gone to another level, it enter in and takes in seven more spirits worse than itself. Listen, all I'm saying is all of us need to know that we're putting down demonic spirits, but we should never be fearful of spirits. I'm not sitting here trying to give you a story about Freddy or Jason, you know, Freddy Krueger. No. All that mess. The name of Jesus is more powerful than any demon out there. The name of Jesus. Come on, lay your hands on the name of Jesus. When your mind's acting up, lay hands on your mind, the name of Jesus. Bring your thoughts back into character. Let them realize who you are. I'm a son of God. I've been through battles. Hold your shield up. Let somebody know you ought to see the dents in this shield. You ought to see the nights I had to pray. There was a night I prayed all night long. When I woke up, I was stronger than I was when I laid down. So all of us have demonic parents. This kind means spiritual direction to do greater things. Prayer and fasting is used because Jesus told disciples, the only way you could get rid of that demon, this one, you got to do some prayer and fasting. That's the key for your next level breakthrough. You got to pray and you got to fast. Then he said, spiritual direction. Some of you need some spiritual direction in your life. Look at Nehemiah. And it came to pass, Nehemiah 1:4, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Look at the separation of fasting and praying. Nehemiah said, I got a burden from the Lord that I'm supposed to do this. Somebody else said, what's the will of God? What's the will of God? How can I go there? He said, I had to pray and fast. Let me give you one more. This kind of trouble, Esther 4 and 16. Go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, fast for me, and neither eat nor drink these 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go unto the king, which is not according to the law, but if I perish, let me perish. Prayer and fasting. We're going to pick up this next week, man. You don't want to miss this. You ought to share this with somebody. But you need to know the next level of your breakthrough. You're not going to be able to handle this. I'm telling you, I can't go there tonight. I'm going to show you where Jesus expects us to fast. He said, that's why some of my children are so weak now. They don't pray and they don't fast. And we're going to talk about the keys to spiritual destiny. We just looked in Nehemiah and Esther, but I could take you to Moses, Daniel. I can show you many patriarchs who made it. And some of you tonight, God told me to share with you. It may hurt your flesh, but you got to take a day. Start off maybe just going to 12 o'clock. I'm going to turn down my plate on purpose and pray and watch the next level breakthrough. We're going to pick up next week and talk about how we incorporate this power of prayer and fasting into our life. This is Pastor Duncan saying, hit us up on YouTube, 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. SBC Praise Church is our hashtag. You can go to Shiloh Baptist 2. We're one church in two locations. Go to our Facebook. Go to our Instagram, SBC Praise Church. Come on, hit us up. We are growing by leaps and bounds, and we just need you to get on board. We will give you a sound word if you follow us. This is Pastor Duncan saying, have a blessed night. And I'll see you on Sunday.